The first of this season's quarterback casualties returns with a victory, while the Bengals suffered their first loss at the hands of Doug Flutie and the Patriots. A long afternoon for Eagles quarterback Randall Cunningham in Cleveland. And they're holding their breaths in Denver as John Elway is taken to the sideline. Another big day in Washington for young Mark Rippon. But another frustrating one sent Jay Schrader to the Raiders' sideline. The Packers made the most of their chances in Minnesota. We'll leave nothing to chance as we hit you with Week 7 next on NFL Primetime. And hello once again, everybody. Welcome to ESPN's NFL Primetime. I'm Chris Berman, along with Tom Jackson, Pete Axthelm, John Saunders will be by shortly as Week 7. Did teams roll a lucky 7? Depends on your point of view. Let's get you caught up now on the late games in the NFL. All of them are now final. A big game out at Los Angeles where San Francisco led big early. The Rams came back to take the lead, but Roger Craig's touchdown early in the fourth quarter, and the 49ers beat the Rams 24-21. They each have two losses now in the NFC West. The team that's in first place, the New Orleans Saints. They held on to defeat the Seahawks up at the Kingdome 20-19, and so the Saints lead the Niners and the Rams by a game in that division. Miami came from way back, 18 points back, and the Chargers came roaring back to beat San Diego 31-28. That game is a final. And the Denver Broncos, some scary moments for a while for John Elway, but x-rays were negative. More on that in a moment. He just a bruised knee, a bruised ankle. He had to leave the game, but they had enough to defeat Atlanta 30-14. Where do we begin? Well, why don't we begin with the team that was the only undefeated team going into Week 7 of the NFL, the Cincinnati Bengals. Now, the New England Patriots, you try and figure them out. Last week, they lose by 42 points to the only team yet to win a game, the Green Bay Packers. This week at home, they go against the team that yet to lose, but with the bubble burst for the Bengals. Early on, Boomer Esiason, who had been close to perfect this season, had his problems. Linebacker Johnny Rembert, interception right here, as Esiason would throw four in the first half alone. Patriots turn into points, but Trey Berry was staying up late this week diagramming this play. Boom! The fumble by Bob Perryman. The touchdown for John Stevens. Just something diagrammed in the playbook. The Patriots lead it 7-0. More troubles for Boomer later in the first half. Esiason looks like he has a touchdown maybe, but Freddie Marion, 31, is called. Yes, he had the interception after they go to the replay booth and they take a close look. This is a tough call, Tommy. You think it was the right one?
Well, a simultaneous catch will go to the receiver unless the play is down. And I think here it was down. A good call by the official.
So the Patriots took the ball over on the turnover. Didn't get any better for Boomer even when they didn't have to go to the replay booth. Here he is. Picked off by Rod McSwain on a tip. And then batted at the line. Picked off by 93 Tim Jordan late in the second quarter. Jordan rumbles down the field. The Patriots turn into a touchdown. A surprise 14-0 lead over Boomer and the Bengals for the Patriots at the half. Doug Flutie making his first start at home. It was a sellout at Shaver Stadium. Flutie was, well, Doug Flutie. Not all the passes were picture perfect, but they got there. Cedric Jones, 32-yard pickup here. And sometimes Doug zipped it. Watch him find number 80, Irving Fryer. That's a pretty play. Flutie didn't pass often until the last couple of drives. 165-yard passing, 36 yards rushing. The Patriots led 20-0 in the third quarter. The Bengals had fourth and goal from the one. The crowd forced them to wait about 2.5 minutes. The Patriots fans finally quiet down enough so that Icky Woods can hear the signals and get the touchdown, and it's 20-7. But Reggie Jepard found the corner on a tough call. Touchdown on an 80-yard drive for the Patriots, 27-14. But back come the Bengals. They don't want to see any losses at all this season. Esiason to Eddie Brown, 16-yard touchdown. Eddie caught a pair of touchdowns today, 27-21. And with 5 seconds to go, the Bengals had the ball down by six. By the same score, they had a shot. Boomer will float it down to the goal line. But on this day, it would be New England. Jim Bowman with the INT. Sam Weish's Bengals are no longer undefeated. Doug Flutie, well, at home, he does the job, doesn't he? As the Patriots shock the Cincinnati Bengals 27-21. After the game, veteran defensive back Raymond Claiborne talked about the wacky world of the New England Patriots.
It's ironic in that we go out and play the worst and lose to them on a lopsided decision, and then we come back home and play the best and beat them. That lets you know parity does exist in the National Football League.
Yeah, and the barometer goes as high and as low when you play for the New England Patriots, who you got to quit trying to figure out. I think, Tom, what we had today was Boomer and Doug Flutie, a difference of style.
Well, Flutie is a guy who has adjusted his style to his size. We always talk about the things that he can't do. He has to roll out because he's so short, has to have that moving pocket with him. But sometimes Flutie has the ability to make things happen because he can do some special things.
Well, let's take a look, because Esiason and Flutie today, and of course today was not Boomer's day, here's what Doug does.
Well, he throws under the rush here. He sees a lane created by his offensive line, is able to throw under the rush. Most quarterbacks, like an Esiason does, they have to throw, come overhand with the football. Esiason does a good job of that. He throws strictly overhand. It's a perfect passing style, but all the time, sometimes at least, you're going to get that ball tipped, and when you get it tipped, there's always the possibility of the interception.
So really, what, Tommy, you're suggesting that if Eddie Goodell were with us today, he would be a tremendous quarterback, the midget, in the National Football League, to throw it under the center's legs. Axe, what the Bengals do for a letdown? They got three division games next.
Well, Chris, somehow I suspected, despite their brilliant coaching and overachieving that they are known for, and I've always said, they would not go undefeated. Let's, as Raymond Claiborne just told us, parity is still a factor. I mean, to compare any team, even if they're undefeated in today's era, to the old Packers or Dolphins or Steelers, like comparing Tammy Faye Baker with Mother Teresa.
You always learn something on this show. You know what I learned about the Patriots? There was a lot of finger-pointing after Flutie came in a couple weeks ago and won the game against the Colts. People said he shouldn't start. There was a lot of internal bickering on the Patriots. They go up and they get whomped at Milwaukee by the Packers, 45-3. So all of a sudden, there's no finger-pointing except at themselves. The Patriots looked themselves in the mirror and said, you know, we stink. Let's not point fingers at our teammates. Let's start with ourselves. And it's amazing, when you're not angry at your teammates, that sometimes you can pull off a win, as they did today, 27-21. A lot of good games to tell you about in Week 7 as primetime rolls on. We've only just begun.
NFL Primetime has been sponsored by Thrifty Car Rental, with over 650 airport and suburban locations worldwide. Sponsor of the ESPN World Tour Sweepstakes to the Pro Bowl. For details on how to enter, call 1-800-525-ESPN. And by United, rededicated to giving you the service you deserve. Come fly the friendly skies. By Michelob, one taste will tell you why the night belongs to Michelob. And by Mazda and the exciting new Mazda cars and trucks for 1989.
You know, Thrifty Car Rental is thrifty price for everyone.
Wow, Hammer,
this is a good deal. Sign it.
It's an offer you can't refuse.
Sign it.
Why don't you get a larger car to entertain friends?
Now I'll sign it.
Enjoy luxury and savings. The all-new Chrysler New Yorker, just $34.95 a day at Thrifty. No advance reservation required.
Go ahead. Make my reservation.
It's simple. Call 1-800-FOR-CARS.
Send up a crossbun. Give me an app check.
There's a place in the friendly skies where not everyone's so friendly.
Stop. Hold it. I need 3 hours minimum.
Check it out.
Over 9,000 mechanics of United Airlines work
here. Give me a mini grinder.
They're picky, fussy, stubborn. But if you fly, they're the best friends you'll ever have. United, rededicated to giving you the service you deserve. Come fly the friendly skies.
Mazda's got a brand new vehicle that's as unique and special and friendly as the family dog. It's the all-new Mazda MPV. It carries seven like a wagon, it's versatile like a van, and with its responsive V6, it performs like a Mazda. If Mazda's MPV sounds like something that's never been before, you're right. About the only thing it won't do is get your paper in the morning. The all-new Mazda MPV. Family transportation. The Mazda way.
Leave it to the good hands, people.
Thinking ahead. It's something you started doing the day you learned how to wish and plan and take measures to help your wishes come true, which is just what Allstate Universal Life helps you to do. To plan while protecting your family and save as your family grows at rates that could help make a lot of your wishes a reality. Allstate Universal Life Insurance, another reason.
You're in good hands with Allstate.
Big battle today in the NFC East, where, surprise, the Phoenix Cardinals had won four in a row, and were on top of the heap, and that included that four-game winning streak, a 30-21 win at home against the Washington Redskins earlier this year. If they could sweep the Skins, they'd have a two-game lead on the defending Super Bowl champions. So on we go to RFK, site of today's game, and it opened up being a passing duel between Neil Lomax and Mark Rippon. And early on, it was Roy Green of the Cards who was running Pro Bowl cornerback Darryl Green all over RFK. Here he beats him over the middle for a 22-yard pickup. And then going one-on-one against Darryl Green shortly after, it was a sideliner this time as he turns the corner and beats him and picks up 20 yards. Man for man, it is tough to cover Roy Green. McDarrell Green's gone up against some of the best man for man lately. This time Green makes the big move outside for a 14-yard gain.
Covered a little soft there, too.
And Tommy, when Lomax combines on a 23-yard touchdown pass, he had what?
The good push-off by the receiver.
Yes, nice work by Roy Green. They had the touchdown, 7-0 Phoenix. But Darryl Green was not an all-pro because he gets beaten for four quarters. He would have some laughs, like the time he stepped in front of Roy Green and made that pretty interception. The Redskins' passing game clicked all day, not only the first half. Mark Rippon looking to the corner for Art Monk. Now, Monk doesn't start on this team. How many teams in the NFL do you think he could start on? Yeah, almost every one. Beat Cedric Mack for a touchdown. Skins led then 9-7. Rippon to Monk again, this time over the middle, and Art could go all the way. 46-yard touchdown. Art Monk caught four on the day as the crowd was cheering him on, and a pair of TDs for number 81. On the sideline in civvies for the fourth straight week, Doug Williams hoping to get back in, but Rippon is going to make it tough. A 303-yard day with four touchdowns. Mark spread the wealth around. It wasn't only Art Monk. Sometimes he got gifts. Travis Curtis looks like he has the interception, but no! Gary Clark off the rebound for the 19-yard touchdown, and Jack Ken Cook says, oh yeah, no problem. Rippon and Clark hook up again. Cedric Mack is beaten, and Gary is off to the races. Nice cut for the 60-yard touchdown as the Skins led it 30-10 at this point. What about the Skins' defense, you ask? Well, that was Gary's stats today. Well, defensively, one of Pete's favorite players, number 50, quote the Raven Caldwell nevermore on this safety. And a replay, you'll see that Caldwell has some leaping ability.
Linebackers sometimes go around, sometimes they go through. A few of them go over.
Over and through for the safety for Caldwell here. The Cards trying to get back in the game a couple times. Fourth and one the second half. But Tony Jordan stacked up at the line of scrimmage. Redskins take over on downs. And fourth and two later in the game for the Cards. Tony Jordan again. Wilbur Marshall stands him up. And when all was said and done, the Washington Redskins look like the champions today, beating back the Cardinals, making everybody in the division just about 4-3, or at least at the top they are, both the Skins and Cards. Final 33-17. And I know, Tommy, we talked about Mark Rippon and Doug Williams on the sidelines, and Rippon isn't playing like a rookie.
Well, earlier on game day, I said I couldn't understand Gibbs not wanting to put Doug Williams back into the lineup when he's healthy. Now, after four TDs and a 303-yard day by Rippon, maybe I should be the one who should be questioned.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time. The Cleveland Browns and the Philadelphia Eagles. Now, the Eagles, with Randall Cunningham drawing raves, coming off the great Monday night performance. Randall, they knew who their quarterback was going to be. For Cleveland, today's starter was Don Strock. It's week 7. It was their fourth starting quarterback of the season. But the Browns are trying to tough it by, and I tell you, probably an attendance record because there's Bernie and Mike Pagel and Gary Daniels. A lot of extra sideline passes these days for the Browns. They're all watching Don Strock, looking at the Tom Matte autographed wristband. First pass for Don, making his first start in 5 years. Picked off by the rookie Eric Allen. Nice return. Eagles couldn't capitalize. And Strock looking to find a rhythm. Frustrating first half for the veteran. Strock will be 38 next month. Not even close to completing this one. Don only completed 5 in the first half, and Marty Schottenheimer saying, well, you know, what can we do? It's 3-3. We're running out of guys. But in the second half, Don Strock found the rhythm. Nice timing counter to Webster Slaughter for the touchdown, 9-3 Cleveland. Webster was only temporarily happy, though, because in the fourth quarter, he would break his left arm in this collision out at least 8 weeks. Yet another Brown on the sideline. But Strock did not lose his touch. Fourth quarter, the zip to Reggie Langhorne. Touchdown. And Don said, yes, sir, I can still play. Meanwhile, another number 12, Randall Cunningham, was finding that Sunday afternoon was not what Monday night was, because Eddie Johnson with the sack there in his face all day long, and Frank Minifield was right, actually, this week.
Well, Minifield said this week, we are not going to play the soft defense that the Giants played at the corners. We're going to put pressure on. This is the kind of pressure. This is one of two interceptions that Minifield took down.
And they also, with good coverage, you can do other things.
Well, Eddie Johnson and Clay Matthews had a field day. Here's Matthews getting one of the nine sacks against Randall.
Nine sacks. And Hanford Dixon said, yeah, well, I'll low-five some dog bones. When the Eagles tried to run, yeah, Keith Byers went to Ohio State. Welcome home, Keith. When they tried to pass, look what happened. The screen, and boom! There's Eddie Johnson laying the lumber. And then a rookie defensive back, Brian Washington. Watch him hit. Boom! You think the Eagles enjoyed themselves? Here's a guy who did enjoy, well, that guy also. Don Strock enjoyed himself. Got the game ball. 11 of 18, 189 yards for Don Strock, and a winner as Cleveland. Their defense has yet to allow a touchdown pass this year. They beat Philadelphia today 19-3. And really, Axe, Cleveland is getting by. They're 4-3. They're winning. They're not disappearing.
Well, this was a real watershed for them today because Cincinnati obviously came in with the big edge over them, undefeated. Cincinnati loses. They're playing a tough team, and they got the job done with Strock playing quarterback. Bernie's warming up, maybe ready to be back next week. If he's not, you know, one thing about Strock, whether it's on a golf course or the football field, he's a quick study, and he showed it today.
Yes, and Don Strock, pretty good hands to have your team in. Now, all of a sudden, with Cincinnati losing, as you mentioned, coming back to the pack, the division is up for grabs, and Cleveland getting guys hurt, but staying in there with a 4-3 mark, two behind Cincinnati. We've got plenty to show you when we come back, but first, that Redskin quarterback decision that Joe Gibbs might have to make soon, it's a tough choice. That's why we're here.
The 1989 Hyundais are here at LeBlanc Hyundai. Why buy an 88 car when you can buy 89 Hyundai from LeBlanc Hyundai for less? Yes, get 89 Hyundais for less than 88s elsewhere. Hello, I'm Clifton LeBlanc at LeBlanc Hyundai, where we just received a gigantic shipment of 89 Hyundais, which gives us the best selection of 89s in the South. So don't buy an 88 car and pay too much. You can buy 89 Hyundai from LeBlanc Hyundai for less than an 88 elsewhere. Hurry, you will save money and get the best service in town only at LeBlanc Hyundai.
I'm Judy Hoff with Cancer Crusaders. For the past 13 years, we have been raising badly needed money for local cancer research at LSU and Tulane Medical Schools. Cancer is a real problem in Louisiana, and we all have a vested interest in making this research a top priority.
So come be a part of our 13th annual charity ball.
This year's theme is classic collectibles, and with cocktails, dinner, and dancing, you'll never have such a good time for such a good cause.
Hey, baby, let's go out there like a bunch of crazed dogs. You have some fun. You mine, baby. Woo! 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 Yeah, Mr. Referee, get on his butt.
Welcome back to NFL Primetime, and welcome back to that perhaps war of words between Chuck Knoll and Jerry Glanville when we last saw them. It was week 15, a year ago. How would the rematch be between the Oilers and Steelers? John Saunders is looking in, John.
Chris, it's a season where very few things are certain. After all, Cincinnati and St. Louis started the day leading their divisions. But one thing was certain. The Oilers and the Pittsburgh Steelers do not like each other. Chuck Knoll calling Jerry Glanville and his boys a bunch of cheap shot artists from last year. You recall they beat them twice. Chuck Knoll was looking for revenge today. Physical tone. Johnson nails Frank Pollard. Pollard has a few words. There was only a hit penalty for 15 yards. Merrill Hodge gets the message from the Oilers. Johnson again, another 15-yard penalty. But the big story was the return of Warren Moon. He started the game, broke his shoulder in week number one. He was back, and the Steelers said they were ready. But Warren Moon looked like the one who was ready. Watch him move to his right and then toss the strike off his back foot to Ernest Givens, and a big play. This touchdown pass to Givens, 43 yards, made it 18-0. Now, why did Warren Moon have so much time? Well, here's the reason. Mike Rozier was in the backfield to give him added protection. Didn't rush the ball as much. Stayed back in there watching out for the quarterback. Todd Blackledge goes to Charles Lockett here. 9 yards on the touchdown. The Oilers have the lead 18-7 at the half. Blackledge then to Lewis Lips. Touchdown right as he gets it in the end zone to make it 18-14. Chuck Noll can't believe it. It's holding on Pittsburgh. That would eventually force a punt. And Harry Newsom's punt is blocked by Chris Dishman. It's just a question of which one of the Oilers is going to pick up the ball for the touchdown. None of them do, but a few plays later, 2-yard play for Alan Pinkett, 25-7 Oilers. The Oilers get right back into it, or they try. Todd Blackledge is struggling. Throws it over the top of his receiver's head, not even close. He was missing his receivers all day long as Warren Moon was making his presence felt. Tosses this one into the end zone to Drew Hill, 24 yards, 34-7, and Warren Moon was back. Remember, he was 11-13 in week number one before getting hit. Ernest Givens had another great day receiving, 143 yards in the touchdown, and Mike Rozier was doing it, blocking for Warren Moon in 20 carries as well for 72 yards. The end of the game, no, these coaches were not about to talk to each other. Glanville went his way, and Noll went the other way. The final, 34-14. The Steelers 1-6, six straight losses, longest losing streak since 16 straight in 69 and 70. The Oilers are 5-2. Meanwhile, the Cowboys and the Bears, and Mike Singletary's running the show. And here's why he's one of the best. Watch Steve Pelor. Should have stayed in the pocket, Steve. He gets crunched by Singletary and Douglas. Watch it again on the replay, and this is scary. Watch his head snap. Boom. Pelor left the game seeing stars and had a concussion, would not return. On the other hand, Jim McMahon, remember he had a concussion last week. Well, Jim shows how it's done. You slide feet first, that way you don't get crunched. That set up the reverse. Neil Anderson to Dennis McKinnon, 4 yards on the touchdown run, and the Bears are on top 7-0. The Cowboys were struggling. Danny White comes in for Pelor, throws the bomb, picked off by David Tate. Now, does he get his feet inbound for the interception? Watch it again. Clearly, he grabs the ball, one's down, and then the other one comes in as well. The Bears get a field goal out of that. It's 10-0. Bears defense like a trap. Steve McMichael gets his third sack of the day. The Bears had 5 sacks, all on Danny White, as Steve Pelor left the game early. McMahon had a big day as well, 22 of 39 and close to 300 yards, the one touchdown. Late in the second quarter, McMahon looking for Ron Morris on the bomb. Watch him turn around, slip inside the end zone. 17-0 Bears to score at the half. Pretty boring in the second half. The Cowboys do march and avoid being shut out on the day as he hands it off to Herschel Walker. There's Danny White. Herschel with 88 yards on 21 carries would set up the only Dallas touchdown, 13 yards to Everett Gay. But the Dallas Cowboys lose it. 17-7 is the final. The Bears sacked Danny White 5 times, as we told you, and that 2-5 start for the Dallas Cowboys is their worst since 1965. The Chicago Bears, however, are now 6-1. Back to you, Chris.
All right, John, thank you. The Cowboys, in a division where everybody seems to be good except for them. Let's start with the Oilers game, Max. And Jerry Glanville, the team is playing as he said that they would, and they're winning ball games. They're playing within themselves.
Well, Glanville said this week that he said when Chuck Noll abused him in that post-game scene last year, he said that gave us an identity. If people want to think of us as the next Raiders, that's fine. And that's what's really happening with the Oilers. They're becoming a feared team. They will beat you up. Speaking of identity, it's my theory that Todd Blackledge is about to make Pittsburgh forget Mark Malone. He may be even worse.
We're trying to get him back. Malone, they're calling for Malone again. And the now the Oilers, just a game back of the Bengals, play them next week. They're 5-2, and the Bengals are 6-1. Tommy, the Bears, they keep losing more players on defense. This week that the two safeties were out, they keep playing pretty good defense.
They continue to lose players, but they certainly don't have to search for an identity. They start two new safeties today. They play with that same aggressiveness, give up only 7 points. Singletary, the glue that holds the Bears together.
Or unglues opposing quarterbacks in this case. We'll be back with a look at the 49ers and the Rams game. Big game out west. First, though, the Oilers. They not only hit hard on defense, they get the results. They have improved. Trust me, it's coming.
You might expect a guy who flies a jet like this
to drive a jet like this. The Mazda MX-6 GT. If you also expect it to fly through the wide open spaces, you're right. But you probably don't expect to find all this wide open space inside. I guess that makes it the one sports coupe which flies in the face of convention. The Mazda MX-6 GT. Sports coupe, the Mazda way.
Someday, when I'm awfully low, when the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you. And the way you look tonight, lovely, don't you ever change. 'Cause I love you just the way you look tonight.
One taste will tell you why.
Just the way you look tonight.
The night belongs to Michelob.
It's been a rivalry for a long time, the San Francisco 49ers and the Los Angeles Rams. This is a big game, though, for the Niners, a game behind the Rams and Saints going in. But a big, bad news for the Rams before the game, that Joe Montana was going to be able to start for the 49ers in 17 games going into today against the Rams. Montana had thrown for 31 touchdowns, 9 interceptions, and completed 65% of his passes. And early on, Joe Montana said, oh, I'm playing the Rams? Good, because I can excel here, but it also helps if I have Roger Craig in my backfield. Here, the quick handoff to Craig, and watch Roger break one tackle, break another tackle, blow over another guy, get a block, outrun two more Rams. And, folks, this is as pretty a 46-yard touchdown run as you'll ever want to see. 7-0 49ers. Jim Everett has been lighting him up this year for the Rams, and he has a lot of rookies who help him out, like wide receiver Aaron Cox from Arizona State. And from 44 yards into the end zone for a touchdown to tie it at, boom, 7. Scary moment for the 49ers here. Jerry Rice goes up for the pass. Jerry Gray defending, has the face mask, pulls him. Watch the right foot. Rice done for the half, but did play a little bit in the second half. That was good news. That play helped set up this one, a hurdle by Craig. Touchdown. Roger Craig on the day, you ask? Well, the former Husker, 22 carries for 190 yards and 3 TDs. It was 17-7 Niners into the third. Well, there's Rice on the sidelines. When Everett throws across the middle off his back foot to Henry Ellard. And quickly, the Rams are within a field goal, 17-14. They didn't stop there. John Robinson's club would have Everett to Buford McGee in the right flat. Takes the stick, gets the touchdown, 21-17. There's Everett's numbers on the day. Fourth quarter, though, the money man today wasn't so much Joe Montana, who left for a while and then came back. It was Roger Craig. I mean, this is unbelievable. 16 yards early fourth quarter, 24-21 Niners. Not much John Robinson can do when Roger Craig has a day like that. And actually, you add up in Rathman and DuBose. Tell you, if the Rams fans probably hate Nebraska now for the way that all those guys can run in the San Francisco 49er backfield. So both clubs are now 5-2. And their real spiritual leader on defense is Ronnie Lott, who came up big in L.A. where he used to play college ball.
Every team has a catalyst for the Bears at Singletary. There's no doubt in my mind for the 49ers it's Lott. The only problem is that sometimes Lott is not there. He's such a hard hitter, such a player that wants to go after it all the time. He ends up hurting himself sometimes. Today he was not hurt. 2 INTs.
You know, when the 49ers won the Super Bowl in 84, all 4 defensive backs, Lott being one of them, went to the Pro Bowl. Dwight Hicks, who was the safety then, along with Carlton Williamson, and a guy named Eric Wright, who's had some injury problems, but I think he's back, Ax.
I thought he had his best day in 3 years today. Wright was all over the place. It was good to see it. But another thing I wanted to mention about the Niners, forget about this quarterback controversy. They put Young in for 3 series. I guess Montana was banged up. His ribs are hurting. They, 3 times, 3 downs and out, the game went from 17-7 Niners to 21-17 Rams while that was going on. Montana... He makes Craig a better runner. He makes guys block harder. In that land of white wine and tofu out in San Francisco, they like to be laid back and reserved about how great this guy is. This is a terrific quarterback, and forget about even questioning whether he should be in the lineup.
And the Niners now have tied the record set by the 60-61 L.A. and San Diego Chargers, 11 straight road wins, and a little plus for the offensive line for the Niners today, who went up against a team that came in with 36 sacks. He did a pretty good job. Roger Craig didn't get all of those yards on his own. When we come back, Bo in KC in Raider colors. Stay with us.
Nobody likes compromises. Everybody wants a car that does everything. The new Mazda 626 handles all those practical things you expect from any family sedan. But it also knows how to handle roads like these. So if there was ever a car that lets you have your cake and eat it too, sure hope you're hungry. Mazda 626, a sophisticated family sedan, the Mazda way.
She absolutely hates me. No way.
No. That's not what
she told me.
You mean...
Live in Britannia.
This is a Peerless do-it-yourself faucet made with solid brass and stainless steel. This is a $7 merchandise certificate. When you buy this, you get this free. Choose toward anything in the store. Where you got this? You got that?
Peerless faucet offer ends October 31st.
What's in a name? The Kemper name means the security of solid insurance protection. For your life, home, business, and auto. Even reinsurance protection. But Kemper's more than insurance. It's Kemper financial products, like mutual funds, annuities, and money market funds, working to bring you better tomorrows. Insurance and investments. Ask for them by name. Kemper.
You think back to the days of the AFL, and there's probably no rivalry better than the Raiders against the Chiefs. All those fantastic games between LaMonica and Dawson, etc. Well, nowadays, when you think Raiders and Chiefs, you think of that famous hobbyist, Bo Jackson, because he plays baseball in Kansas City. As a matter of fact, just 2 weeks ago, he was finishing playing his baseball season with the Royals at Royal Stadium. First game in pro football this year across the street at Arrowhead, which is why they sold out the place for the first time since 86. There's Bo with another running back of pretty good skills, Marcus Allen. First quarter, Bo with a 10-yard run, helped setting up a Raider touchdown. Bo, not a tremendous day, but I mean, the guy's only had 10 days off from a whole baseball season. He had 70 yards, a touchdown later in the game, and he fired the ball into the crowd. They gave him a nice ovation. Steve DeBerg hit Paul Palmer for 48 yards. And the Raiders' 14-0 lead was pared to 14-7. Palmer catching five passes today. And at the beginning of the second half, Palmer looked like he would be celebrating some more because he takes the kick at the five. And watch what happens, except you'll notice these ugly little yellow things. Chris Barr, you think he's going to catch him? Nah. Why bother? Palmer, 95 yards for a touchdown. But referee Bob McElwee says, Paul, flag against the Chiefs. In the fourth quarter, it got worse. Here is a punt by Jeff Gossett. Watch Kendrick Taylor. Doink off the helmet. Stephen Adams recovers in midair. Raiders offense not dynamic, though, with all those breaks. As a matter of fact, Jay Schrader put on the cap in the second half after a 7-for-17 performance. And Steve Berline came in, was 4-of-7 for 70 yards and a 4-yard touchdown pass to Trey Junkin. That point, it was 20-10. They traded touchdowns after that. And the Raiders went on to beat the Chiefs in Kansas City, 27-17. At Minnesota, the Pack and the Vike at 63,000 on hand at the Hubert H. Humphrey Home Dome. Backup quarterback Don Majkowski has a little trouble with the snap. This was a bizarre game at times. Chris Dolman goes after it. Watch what happens here. Then we can play footy. We're going to kick it. And the loss on the play. So Lindy Infante put on his thinking toque, and he says, you know what we need? We need a good punt return. And the Packers have a good guy in Walter Stanley. He was consistent, getting 10, 15 yards a clip, and got the Packers going. Defense, 235-pound linebacker Tim Harris, sacks
Wade Wilson for the safety. Tim had a huge day. More on that in a moment. Brent Fullwood scored the first Packer touchdown, but he was injured with a left ankle sprain in the second quarter, did not return. His backup today did a nice job. That was Keith Woodside, had over 50 yards, 54 to be exact. Joey Browner finally wrestles him down there. The Packers led it 9-0 on a 3rd and 14 situation in the second quarter. Watch Don Majkowski making his second start in replace of Randy Wright. Football! And the Vikings pick it up. It's Reggie Rutland. But football! And Keith Uecker with the best seat in the house falls on the ball. First down pack. They would go in for a touchdown later, make it 16-0. Bucky Scribner has his punt blocked and caught out of the air by that same man, 97 Tim Harris, who also had two sacks. Safety, touchdown on the block, two sacks. They're dancing. And the Packers need to perfect this. Lindy, watch what happens when he wins a second in a row. You know, that hurts. Gatorade is one thing. That hurts. The Packers go on to surprise the Minnesota Vikings in an awfully big way. Boy, they seem to win almost every year up in the Metrodome. Final score is 34-14. And all of a sudden, the Vikings are two games. They humiliated the Bears, but all of a sudden, they're two games behind the Bears in the NFC Central. And all of a sudden, Lindy Infante is a regular winner in the NFL, Alex.
Well, I've been saying all year, of course, when you talk to people around the league who have worked with Lindy Infante, Bernie Kosar, Kenny Anderson, Chris Collinsworth, these guys swear by him. This is a great offensive mind. He also gets guys to play hard, and it's starting to show. The other big thing I think the Packers have going with them, how can you not like a team that their offensive backfield? They got guys Fullwood, Woodside. When your offensive backfield is named after like what sounds like a condominium development, maybe you're all right.
Majkowski Acres. Yeah. I might move in there. Tommy, the Raiders, yes, they won today on the road against the Chiefs, but what's going on at quarterback?
Well, good thing they had Bo. In Los Angeles, they've said that Schrader is the answer. The question is what is that question?
We'll leave that to Alex Trebek on the next episode of Jeopardy. When we return, are we in Jeopardy? No. John Saunders is by to look at late games and the Axe's Edge. It's a cutting edge. Stay with us.
In three words or less, tell us why you prefer Thrifty car rental.
You don't have to be wealthy or well-known to rent any of Thrifty's new Chrysler cars. Thrifty is...
May I remind the affiliates we may run a little over tonight.
Enjoy luxury and savings. The all-new Chrysler New Yorker, just $34.95 a day at Thrifty. No advance reservation required.
Have you ever noticed how some people can't come out and say Thrifty price for everyone? Have you ever noticed that? Call 1-800 for cars.
Husky, born to work, bred to last, pound for pound, nothing works like a Husky. The Husqvarna Chainsaw, they call it Husky. Raw power and lightweight make it the professional's choice. It won't let you down. Nothing works like a Husky. The Husky Model 40 is now only $259.95. See the yellow pages for your nearest Husqvarna dealer.
The shower massage by Teledyne Waterpik.
Leave it to the good hands, people.
Yesterday, when George Tucker left the Allstate Claim Center across the street, he figured the only thing that'd bring him back was the pie he'd discovered. Unfortunately, the long, hot drive home exposed other minor damage that had gone undetected. Just the kind of thing Allstate Hidden Damage Protection insures him against. So today, Allstate gave George another check and a great new excuse for more pie. Allstate Hidden Damage Protection, another reason.
You're in good hands with Allstate.
Just as the San Francisco 49ers have won 11 straight road games, pretty good road team out of the NFC West is the New Orleans Saints. They were at a tough place today in Seattle. John Saunders had an eye on it, John.
The New Orleans Saints, Chris, 5-1 off to their best start ever. And this is a team that's won 17 of their last 21 regular season games. They're trying to make it 6-1, and with the Rams playing the 49ers, they could be alone atop the leaderboard in the NFC West. A full house at the Kingdome. They're out to see a family affair. John Tice of the Saints and brother Mike Tice of the Seahawks. Each brother made the stat sheet, not in a big way. Bobby Hebert hits John Tice 13 yards on this reception in the first quarter, his only catch of the day. Later on, Kelly Stauffer finds Mike Tice just 5 yards on the toss. He would catch 3 for 22 yards. The Seahawks were able to get into it in the first half because of turnovers. Mel Gray muffs a punt. Grant Fiesel will cover it for Seattle near midfield. 3 takeaways for Seattle, 22 on the year, and that would lead the league coming into the game. Bobby Hebert, the only 1 touchdown in the first half, looking 19 yards to Eric Martin. This would be enough to give the Saints the lead at halftime, 10-6, as he hauls in the touchdown wide open in the end zone. Where's the cover? Norm Johnson, 4 field goals in the game, but on this play, Gene Atkins blocks the kick. Dave Wehmer, it bounces right up into his hands, 58 yards. He's off to the races. Look at this, high five before they get into the end zone at the 20-yard line. Is that confidence? 20-12, New Orleans. Seattle would not lie down. 2 rookies make a search. Kelly Stauffer going to Brian Blades. And then Blades with a terrific run, 51 yards before he's done. Brett Maxey on the tackle. Blades caught 9 passes before today. He had 8 catches today, late in the fourth quarter, with 42 seconds left of the game. Kelly Stauffer looks for Blades once again, 4-yard touchdown, and it's 20-19. Kelly Stauffer with a big day numbers-wise, 370 yards passing, but just the 1 touchdown. Seattle tries the onside kick. Eric Martin leaps to get the ball, and the Saints hang on to win. And coach Rusty Tillman looks on, cannot believe it. 20-19 is the final. The Saints are now 6-1 and alone atop the NFC West. Meanwhile, it was the Dolphins and the San Diego Chargers in the AFC. The 4 M's of football, much maligned Mark Malone at the helm for San Diego. Here he hooks up with Jamie Holland, who shows some quick feet to gain 28 yards. Malone connected on his first 5 passes. The next play, 16 yards to Quinn Early on the touchdown. As he jumps and gets it, the Chargers are up 7-0. 14-10, Chargers on top. Dan Marino destroys Troy Stradford. But he coughs up the football and San Diego recovers. And Malone and company would capitalize on the turnover. Here he goes to Darren Flutie. That's right, Flutie, Doug's younger brother. Touchdown, his first in the National Football League. 21-10, the Chargers led at the half. And Mark Malone, who has the 2 M's in front of his own name, was putting up a pretty good day at that point. Lionel James fields the Reggie Roby punt. Some fancy footwork. It's Jim Jensen who nails him, and the ball is coughed up. James fumbles it, and Little Train can't believe he gave it up. He wasn't done. That sets up Lorenzo Hampton, 3 yards on the touchdown run to make it 21-17. And Don Shula's on the sideline, says, hey, we're back into this, we can win it. Third quarter, Marino to Farrell Edmonds out of the University of Maryland. A great grab as he gets it down there. Marino had a good day, another 300-yard passing day for Dan Marino. San Diego leading it 28-24. Lionel James takes the handoff, gets stuck right in the numbers, and yes, coughs it up again, and the Dolphins recover. The turnover would lead to Troy Stradford. 3-yard run, which proves to be the difference in the game. 31-28 is the final. Miami wins it. The 27th 300-yard game for Dan Marino, second only to Dan Fouts. At Mile High Stadium, the Broncos and the Atlanta Falcons. And the Broncos were tough at Mile High, and here's why. John Elway to number 84, Ricky Nateel. Nateel makes the grab, hauls it in, and hangs on to it at the 16-yard line. The Broncos are in business. This would set up Elway looking for number 80 this time. Mark Jackson, 14 yards. As Elway zips it in there as only he can, the Broncos lead it 7-0. That was the good news for John Elway. Tony Casillas wraps him up here. Watch, his body goes one way and his torso goes the other way. Elway suffered a sprained right knee and ankle, had to leave the game. And at this point, it is only a sprain. It looked much worse at the time. With Denver up 17-7 and John Elway headed towards the sidelines, the Atlanta Falcons would try and take advantage of them losing their leader. Settle, second touchdown of the day, hauls in the 1-yard touchdown pass. Atlanta's closing is now 17-14. Gary Kubiak was the quarterback that came in for John Elway. 68 yards, he lofts this one to Steve Sewell,
right on the money. Takes it in the end zone for the touchdown, and the Broncos do go on to win it 30-14. Chasing now and catching Seattle in the AFC West after the Denver Broncos had gotten off to such a terrible start, Chris.
John, let's go back to New Orleans, a team that, along with the Bears, have the best record in the NFC at 6-1. The Saints don't look impressive, but I guess they don't care if they're impressive, do they? They just win.
Exactly. Coming into the game, they'd won their games by a margin of 5 points, and they win today by just 1 point. But it's a tribute to Jim Moore and his staff. He knows what he has. He doesn't have the most talented team in the National Football League, but he makes the most of exactly what he has, devises his game plan against the guys that he has, and they are now 18-4 over their last 22 football games and sitting alone atop of the NFC West.
And they are 9-1 in their last 10 road games. So they and the Niners, boy, just put them on the road in that division and they never lose. Plus, they get the big play from the specialty teams and they just don't turn the ball over very much. When Hebert tried to go long, he was picked off. The pass is short, gives it to Hayward and the guys. They look a lot better. When we return, how would the Giants look? Could they look any better than they did on Monday night? We'll let you know.
Another Tony's Kitchen Sink special?
That's right.
Rebuilt starters, $14.95 and up.
But who gets to keep the sink?
Who else would want it?
It's the craftsman. It's the mechanic. It's all of us. We're the great American investors. We invest in U.S. savings bonds because bonds pay competitive rates. Find out more. Call 1-800-US-BONDS.
Don't miss any of the exciting action this season as ESPN Cox Cable Channel 14 presents its second big year of NFL football.
The NFL on ESPN is brought to you in part by U.S. agencies. It's not that you can't afford auto insurance, it's just that you haven't found auto insurance that you can afford. And Lesson Chevrolet, 1501 West Bank Expressway, Harvey.
The NFL on ESPN, Cox Cable Channel 14. It's your ticket to the NFL Sunday night action where the best go head-to-head.
Monday night loss at Philadelphia. The Giants came home to face the Detroit Lions, and they'll play them again in 2 weeks from now. Giants and Lions at the Meadowlands, and Phil Simms says, hold the pepperoni, but I'll have everything else in the pizza. Rusty Hilger says, can you call back a little later?
I think so.
Giants up 7-0 in the second. Hilger running around looking for some time, and hey, there's Gary James. Touchdown. It was this easy? 7-7 tie. Nice job by the offensive line. Third quarter, the Giants begin to dominate, though. Phil Simms looking long to Stephen Baker, second-year receiver. And Baker has the step and the touchdown. 51-yard Giants led 14-10. Phil Simms, a nice, solid day for Phil. Giants defense, this time the line does well, but no one's open, and Lawrence Taylor comes up with the sack. This time, the line doesn't do so well, and Lawrence Taylor comes up with the sack. And then this time, the defense does so well that he's called for intentional grounding. Hilger at about his own one-yard line. The second half offense for the Lions, 13 yards. Here's a play that summarizes the Lions' season after an opening win they haven't won since. They take the kickoff in the end zone, but a penalty is called. It really was. And number 97, Dan Salamua, was called for a penalty. So they get the ball deep, and then he takes on somebody in the end. Oh, you want to come out here and fight? And Darrell Rogers says, hey, no, you come here. Hey, Dan, guess what? The game is out there. You don't pay attention to those guys over there. You may not be out here anymore if you do that. Dan was quiet for the rest of the day. Dan Salamua getting the lashing from Darrell Rogers. Could it get any better than that? Well, if you're a Giant fan, maybe. That was kind of fun, though. Joe Morris, 8 yards. And the Giants go on to waste the Detroit Lions by a count of 30-10 in the Meadowlands. On to Indianapolis, the Bucks and Colts, and there's the NFL football with Pete Axthelm's signature on it. Tampa Bay continues to give up points in the first quarter. What is it now, 71-0 against them in the first quarter? Chris Chandler on the flea flicker to Billy Brooks. Pick up a 23 yards. And Brooks would catch a touchdown later in the game, and a marvelous catch, caught 7 overall. Early second quarter, the Colts lead at 7-3. Watch our kickers and bounce up the middle here. and make his cut. Nice cut in the 12. Bulls into the end zone, 27 yards. It's 14-3 Colts. Dickerson, 80 yards. And they're on their way to an easy win because rookie Chris Chandler was 19 of 32 for 240 yards. Late in the third, it's 28-10. And Vinny Testaverde is picked off badly by Eugene Daniel. He could go all the way. 38 yards for number 38. It's a 35-10 laugher into the fourth quarter. But here comes Mr. Fourth Quarter himself, Vinny Testaverde in the box. They've scored 61 points in the fourth quarter. Here's a touchdown by John Smith. It's the second touchdown for the Bucs in the fourth quarter, and the lead is down, is cut by seven. Next possession, first and 10 at midfield. Testaverde to Bruce Hill. That's a touchdown. Now the Colts lead is 11. The next possession, same thing. Testaverde to Frank Tears on My Pillow, who makes a great catch of 24 yards. They would go in to get another score, and it's down to a four-point game, 35-31. Now, do you remember last week when a Hail Mary was answered by Stephen Starring? This time he is out of bounds. The Bucs have no timeouts left. They try to get it, but no. They run out of time. They run out of the ball. But the nice comeback with 21 points in the fourth quarter as the Indianapolis Colts get a rare win, only their second on the year. But they have to pay for it as they just hold off the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, who are getting close again, 35-31. When we return, the axe's edge. One note we should make on Vinny. He and Dan Marino, the only two quarterbacks who within 2 years in the pros who have thrown for over 400 yards. You saw Vinny 469 on the day. And on a day when Don Strock, Doug Flutie, Chris Chandler, Mark Griffin, Don Majkowski were winners, these are now the standings.
When you rent from some car companies these days, you can really get soaked. That's why I'm ecstatic about Thrifty Car Rental. Their rates and new Chrysler cars certainly won't murder your wallet.
Enjoy luxury and savings. The all-new Chrysler New Yorker, just $34.95 a day at Thrifty. No advance reservation required.
Call Thrifty. They're thrifty price for everyone. Oh, and call me for dry cleaning.
No.
Yes, you even had the same tie on.
I couldn't have the same tie. I just got this tie yesterday.
Well, see there, I proved my point.
Your dream was 2 days ago.
Oh, yes, you don't know someone with long blonde hair like this?
Live in Britannia.
This is a Peerless do-it-yourself faucet made with solid brass and stainless steel. This is a $7 merchandise certificate. When you buy this, you get this free. Choose toward anything in the store. Well, you got this. You got that?
Peerless faucet offer ends October 31st.
I'll tell you, it's a tough job, but someone has to do it. Watch all these games at once, nine of them at 1 o'clock, and you go bug-eyed. It acts, though, not only were you watching the games cross-eyed, you were seeing stripes, weren't you?
I see a lot of stripes. And, of course, everyone knows that I've always said that the officials in the National Football League do a tremendous job week after week. But occasionally you see these little flaws. Today, I saw several. Let's take a look. Kelly Goodburn of the Chiefs drops back. Here comes the Raider rush. They crush this guy. This guy is lucky he got up from this hit. Oh, there he goes. No flag, of course. The zebra apparently was looking downfield. Then comes Jim Arnold of the Lions. Now, Tom Flynn of the Giants just brushes him. He does a good swan dive. He gets the flag. But I'm just using all this as a prelude. It's the worst call in the history of Western civilization. Kelvin Bryant misses this pass, takes a little nudge from Tim McDonald of the Cardinals, and there goes the flag. An amazing call, but then again, the Zebras never cease to amaze you. That's what they're there for.
Speaking of a little nudge, you were 12-17 and needed a little nudge to get going here. Raiders were one thing that got you going today.
I needed a big nudge, actually, and of course, I love to bet on bad teams, as you know. I love to find
bad teams, right?
To bet against. Or, you know, like that's why I'm always betting like Tampa Bay, Green Bay games. In this case today, I found one bad team that was a wrong favorite. The Kansas City, no way they should have been favored by 3.5 over the Raiders. And it was also very satisfying for me to see the Silver and Black, one of my favorite teams, finally get back in action. Van McElroy with his two interceptions, he's been hurt most of the year, and very satisfying to see that. Also, Raiders hadn't had a sack in a couple of weeks, and they did it. And then there was Shanahan before the game said, Schrader's got confidence, and I've got confidence in him. And that was sure borne out when he benched him in the second half. But I'll take the victory.
But, yeah, but wait a minute. Now you're complaining when you win. Why don't you complain when you lose? You've gotten used to that, like on Phoenix.
Like, speaking about Phoenix, they're a desert mirage. They quit like prairie dogs when they get into Washington. They've only played two teams in their division, both in Phoenix and the Heat. They got on the road in RFK, a really stupid pick. Fortunately, uncharacteristically for this year, I don't, that was my only stupid pick, 3-1.
A 3-1 day is that moving pocket and the moving Mendoza line for you as you're climbing up the ladder with a pick on Monday night. Here's the Axe's record, and he's on, Tommy, he's on our Bills.
Our Bills.
Our Bills. We'll be back.
Get your hands on the computer that's changing the way American business, industry, and government computes at the Computer Source Macintosh Business Exposition, October 21st and 22nd at the Baton Rouge Hilton. Computer Source has assembled the largest array of Macintosh computers and peripherals ever displayed in Louisiana. So bring your purchasing agent to the Computer Source Macintosh Business Exposition, October 21st and 22nd at the Baton Rouge Hilton. Be there.
Computer Source, your authorized Apple Macintosh dealer.
Don't just take what's there.
Hey, lady, paint your house. $50 up front.
Rely on professionals who've built a good reputation and are licensed and insured.
Hi, I'm Gary Catalano with Catalano's Home Improvement, and we are the professionals you need to call for your next project. We've built an excellent reputation in New Orleans for over 15 years of quality work at an honest and fair price. From painting to room additions and everything in between, we're AAA rated to make your next home improvement a smashing success. So call Catalano's Home Improvement.
NFL Primetime has been sponsored by Mazda and the exciting new Mazda cars and trucks for 1989, by Britannia, live in Britannia, and by Thrifty Car Rental, with over 650 airport and suburban locations worldwide, sponsor of the ESPN World Tour Sweepstakes to the Pro Bowl. For details on how to enter, call 1-800-525-ESPN.
Remember, just 2 weeks from now, our Sunday night games begin. It will be Washington and Houston, and that's shaping up into quite a contest. So, let us recap week 7 of the NFL for you, in case you missed the scores earlier. Redskins split their series with Phoenix this year, coming back today at home. Big day for Mark Rippon, beating the Cards 33-17. Cincinnati goes into New England 6-0, leaves 6-1. Six turnovers as New England shocks them 27-21. Cleveland Browns with Don Strock at quarterback, sack Randall Cunningham 9 times. They beat Philadelphia 19-3. Houston winning at Pittsburgh handily. Warren Moon returns to the starting lineup, 34-14 Oilers. Chicago's defense continues to impress. They knock Pelora out. White hurt late in the game for Dallas, 17-7 Bears win. Giants started slowly but measured the Lions eventually, 30-10 at the Meadowlands. The Pack roaring to their second straight win. Hey, they host Washington next week at Milwaukee. That could be a very good game, 34-14 the Pack. Raiders, Bo Jackson back into Kansas City. He wins as a Raider, 27-17. Indianapolis gives up 3 fourth-quarter touchdowns, but they win 35-31 over Tampa Bay. San Francisco, a big win for them at the Rams, 24-21. Roger Craig, 190 yards. New Orleans goes into the Kingdom. They win on the road again. They beat Seattle 20-19. Miami spots San Diego a big lead, but roars back to win 31-28. Denver over Atlanta, 30-14. The Monday night game is Buffalo at the Jets, and Monday night matchup with John and Sam Ratiglione and Ali Sherman at 8 Eastern time. And a reminder that next week on game day, we get you set for the entire week for an hour every morning at 11:30 a.m. Every Sunday morning. It was every morning, then we all have a scoop. Let's go back to the Raiders, Tommy, because the AFC West, your division, 4-3 is the top spot, and the Raiders are close. Really, everybody's close.
I love that too. One of my favorite sports. And we didn't have the sufficient facilities, you know, naturally, and in an environment such as the one I've come from.